the Digmars team and Iceland Space Agency. And what we're doing is exploring Iceland for terrestrial analogs of Mars. And so our team name stands for Digging Iceland Geology for Mars Analog Research. Thorpe. I'm a sedimentary geochemist that works at Jacobs, a contractor to NASA Johnson Space Center. We're almost ground truthing what we're seeing on Mars, but providing kind of a reference frame for what we're seeing from these rover results.
We are at Sandvatn, which is a small lake here in Iceland. We come here, a lot of us planetary geologists who are interested in Mars or the Moon come to Iceland because the rock types are very similar to what we find on Mars and the Moon.
Start with the Mars side of things. Is Mars has an ancient rock record that shows us that it had running water at one time, and it had these expansive lakes. And so we come to places like Iceland, which happens to be a very good analog for ancient Mars, and we're exploring lakes in Iceland to kind of unravel what we're seeing on Mars.
There are a couple of rovers on Mars, actually, right now. Everybody's really excited about the recent landing of Perseverance in Jezero crater this past February. So it's been up there almost 6 months now. There's another rover that's been up there since August 2012, and that's the Curiosity rover. These are both sites, Gale, where Curiosity is, and Jezero crater, where Perseverance is, are both sites of ancient lakes. And we could tell that from orbital images based on the morphology of the rocks. And so with Curiosity, we are studying the chemistry and mineralogy of these lake sediments that were deposited about 3.5 billion years ago. And we're seeing some really interesting changes in some of those minerals that formed in liquid water. So specifically iron oxides, clay minerals, sulfate salts. We have many hypotheses for those changes in mineralogy, but they're still just hypotheses. And so coming here to an analog site for what lakes in Gale Crater Mars might have looked like 3.5 billion years ago, we're drilling into these sediments, studying the chemistry and mineralogy to compare to what we found with Curiosity. What's especially interesting about Perseverance in Jezero is that Perseverance has the capability of drilling small cores, maybe 10 centimeters long, and eventually there will be a couple of missions to return those samples to Earth to study the chemistry and mineralogy in situ. We hope by studying these sediments here that can also inform the types of minerals that we will see returned from the Perseverance rover. We'll be right back.
what we see on Mars today is a desiccated landscape, but back, we're talking 3.5 to 4 billion years ago, it may have been very Icelandic-like. And so Mars is really made of similar basaltic rocks that Iceland's made of, so that's already check one for a good analog. But the climate itself, we've looked at the extent of chemical weathering, and we have some results out there that show that the climate in Iceland is very conducive to kind of limited chemical weathering, similar to what we're seeing from the rovers on Mars. And so it's not just the climate that is good here, the rocks as well, and we're also seeing the evidence for water on Mars. And so we go to kind of these lake environments that are similar to what the rock record of, say, Jezero crater or Gale crater are showing us. We have these dried up lake beds, we have these dried up deltas, and it's very similar to what we would expect to core into Iceland here. And so these sedimentary rocks at one point were at the surface and they were buried at depth. And so that's kind of why we're digging down here too, to kind of get a better sense of what happens to these sediments when they're buried and they're interacting with groundwater, lake waters, and so on and so forth, to kind of change the composition. In Iceland, we have the unique ability to actually deploy drones that are going to be using thermal infrared spectrometers to identify where we might have groundwater discharging into the lake. But we also have boats that are out there. They're taking chemical measurements of the water themselves and trying to identify where groundwater is discharging into the lake, comparing the signatures of groundwater to lake water to kind of get a better idea of how these two mix. And we're trying to focus on how this affects the overall sediment composition. And so where we find that groundwater is discharging into the lakes, we're taking drills there. So we're going down about 10 feet into the sediments themselves. We're gonna pull up those drills. We're using a vibrocore to get down that deep. We're gonna split those drills open. We're gonna subsample each part of those drills, and we're gonna look at the biology in the sediments. We're gonna look at the pore water that's in between the sediments in these rocks, and we're gonna analyze the chemistry, the mineralogy, and isotopes, all these different tools that we can throw at these sediments on Earth here to kind of give us a more concrete foundation for making these interpretations on Mars when we are using similar techniques, but we're unable to kind of throw such a dynamic suite of instruments at it.
Just as we have observed fluvial geomorphological processes occurring on Mars as we have on Earth, it's not a stretch of the imagination to think that hydrogeology and groundwater transport occurring on Earth could also be occurring on Mars. So same skill set, same toolbox, different location.
Lake like this in Iceland, Lake Sandvon, could have been Gale crater or the Jezero crater lakes ancient billion years ago, and that's kind of what we're trying to unravel with the current sedimentary layers that we are seeing in these cores. Behind me we also have a boat that is going to take lake water samples, and we're going to compare those to the groundwater samples that we're getting from these pore water holes. This is all groundwater that is either recirculating with the lake waters, or it's diffusing through the sediments into the lake waters. And this is going to create a unique signature both geochemically and mineralogically in the sediments. And we'll be able to unravel what these signatures are. And so we're sampling both the sediments and the waters that are in these holes. Yeah, so groundwater seeps through the ground, it's interacting with the rock, it's breaking down the rock, and it's taking a bunch of the elements that are in that rock into the water itself, so it's dissolving a lot of those things as well. Lake water is kind of well, it's surface water, and so it doesn't interact with the water as, or with the rocks nearly as long as, so it doesn't have as much of the elements that came from those original rocks. And so together, they have kind of two different flavors of, I say signatures, but kind of elemental composition, different chemistry, and different mineralogy. And so we can kind of, you know, put lake water over here, we can put groundwater over here, and then we can also see where they mix by seeing what the elements are in both of those. And relating this to another planet, why Mars may not currently have water, we can look at the sediments themselves, see how these groundwater and lake water signatures are preserved in the sediments, and then eventually how it's turned into a sedimentary rock, and that's what we're left with on Mars. So being able to kind of dig into Mars and look at the geochemistry, the mineralogy, biology if present, looking for organics, and seeing what the change is from these water compositions is going to be big for unraveling its ancient climate, ancient history.
In addition to understanding kind of the mineralogy of what's going on with the groundwater interacting with the lake, we want to understand the water chemistry, and it's also important to understand the biology because, you know, life is pretty pervasive on our planet, and life definitely exists in the subsurface, and we want to understand, you know, what kind of life is possibly living in the sediments, especially in the sediments that are saturated with groundwater, how that's different from the lake, and how that could be contributing to, you know, the different types of rocks and minerals and the changes that we're seeing from the groundwater sourcing all the way out to the lake.
Yeah, so we use a combination of geochemical and geophysical tools to identify water sources and to assess the discharge or recharge of groundwater into these lake bodies. So for the geophysical methods, we're using temperature transducers fixed in rods to assess how the temperature may change with depth as a function of groundwater flowing vertically upwards or to recharge the lake bottom. And then we're using geochemical tools, including water stable isotopes, to try and fingerprint these different water masses, whether it's the proglacial lake and the rivers feeding the lake, or specific different groundwater springs and other end members. So that, in combination with measurements of organic carbon, inorganic carbon, trace elements, all of this will help paint a picture about these different water masses that are playing within this lake system.
Understand how lakes on Mars work. We now know that Mars had abundant lakes on it, and we want to understand how those lakes formed, and what did the chemistry of those lakes look like, and what did the sediments that the lakes deposited look like, and what was the potential for life, not only in the lakes but in the sediments. And we also know now that there was potentially a lot of groundwater moving through the subsurface of Mars, and that included moving through the subsurface of the sediments in the lake. And so we really want to have an understanding of what that groundwater was doing to those sediments, those subsurface sediments.
Is composed of very specialized individuals, and so for instance Joe is really good at identifying where groundwater is by using these radionuclides in the water. Liz is a mineralogist that is on the Kenman instrument for the Curiosity rover and is one of the best at identifying various minerals, especially secondary minerals that are in these rocks that we drill on Mars, but she's got a ton of field experience as well. We have Kirsten Seebach, who is at Rice University and is also on the 2020 rover, the Perseverance rover team, and she specializes in sedimentology and looking at the geochemistry as well. We have Kenda Lynch from the Lunar Planetary Institute. She's an astrobiologist and knows how to identify biological signatures in the sediments and how that can be extrapolated to Mars as well. We have two amazing graduate students from Rice University here, that are gathering information on sedimentology, as well as flying drones to get high resolution imagery of our terrains here, and also sampling the provenance terrains to kind of understand how these sediments are altered from source to sink. So taking them from the mountainous terrains where the glaciers are up there and transporting them downstream. And that's Ross and Audrey from Rice University are contributing to this work as well. And then, not even to touch on what the Iceland Space Agency has done to get us here with logistics, but also the extent of planning and helping us throughout this is like no other. And so we have a unique team that is really coming together to accomplish quite a bit of goals that I don't know if we could do without each other.